medium of paint is the most magical medium, I think, because of the transformative nature. It can be thin, it can be thick, it can be translucent, it can be opaque. It all changes depending upon who's wielding the brush, because it's the most primitive method of making art. It is inspiration in your brain, out through the arm and out through the most primitive of tools, hair on a stick. You go back to the cave paintings in Lascaux, it's the original art form. Cousins. We were all Catholic school kids and blue collar, working class Chicano background. But we were all bright kids and we got bound together and we challenged each other. The head cousin, my cousin Louis, who was brilliant, and just a brilliant guy, and he organized us and he assigned us topics to go out and learn about and bring back to the group. Okay, Regine, you learn about the Middle Ages. Lolly, you learn about science. Cheech, you learn about art and bring it back to the group. Okay, so how do you do that? So I went to the library and I took out all the art books. Okay, Cézanne, Picasso, Caravaggio. And so I started studying that. When I was a young Chicano kid in South Central, it wasn't predominantly black. It was black. you knew the people that weren't black in the neighborhood, you know, because you could count them on the fingers of one hand. I was of the culture because that's what the culture was, and all my friends were black, and everybody in school and teachers. But you're still other. Then when I moved from South Central to Granada Hills, which was all white, and one day everybody was black, and the next day everybody was white. And I was still the outsider in that culture. I was of them, but not of them. And when I kind of got into the Chicano culture, and more in college, that was when it started to emerge in the late 60s, and it was the civil rights movement of the Chicano period. I learned very quickly that every Mexican American was not Chicano. Chicano is a voluntary category. You have to proclaim yourself a Chicano in order to be a Chicano. There's no box on the census that you can check that says Chicano, none. But you can get a PhD in Chicano studies from Harvard University. So what is the message? We exist, we don't exist. It allows you an observational post. You can be the observer, participant and observer at the same time, simultaneously. And it's a voluntary category. So as a voluntary category, you can make up your own rules. And that's what I like.
I've got two other sons. Yeah. One's 16, the other one's just turned 18, but when he was 17, fell in love for the first time. Fell in love, she was mad in love, and they, you know, he was with his girl for, they were steady for a few months.
Yeah.
And then, yeah. Then she let him go, you know.
The way of all flesh,
you know,
yeah.
Let him go, ruined him.
Oh.
You know, I mean, you know, he locked himself up in his room, you know, he was skipping class. I mean, he just, you know, just went to all the, you know, and I remember the emotion of the first time I got my heart broken.
Whoa.
You know, and that's a mean beast.
Heartbreaking.
Yeah, it's an animal. You know,
takes over.
So I started this, and it's about basically el embrujado. It's a man in love.
Beautiful.
the early Chicano painting or art movement was the physical the artistic face of the civil rights movement, Chicano civil rights movement. They were indistinguishable. And so all Chicano art at that beginning was political art, and very defiant political art. That's kind of one of the definitions of Chicano, which has a defiant political attitude. If you didn't have a clenched fist, a barbed wire, a sacred heart, and a cactus, and an eagle in your paintings, that was considered, and it was categorized as agitprop folk art. Okay. I'm sure it worked for that little period, but artists, as you know, they seek their own level or medium. It's like they're like water, you know. They find their own level, and they started evolving as artists and started evolving their own artistic visions that wasn't necessarily political. And so there was a period of disengagement from that, started by the first guy that was the theorized of a Chicano school of art, Carlos Almaraz. He came back from New York. He was disillusioned with the art scene that was going on there, and he came back to L.A. and joined Cesar Chavez in the grape fields, and Luis Valdez in the Teatro Campesino. He made backdrops for them, made placards. And then as soon as he established that, he kind of left that. And I love that progression. To tell you the truth, I think that's because you're not gonna get great art out of artists that you confine to a category. It's just not gonna happen.
Pleasure to be here in the South Texas Music Room once again for our third show. I'm sorry, I hope I don't get the flu because everybody's dying from that.
And I want to live.
Yo, no, I'm in the kill zone right now. You know? That age, you know, it's like walking through a minefield. And so I started collecting this, and now we're at the point we've played in over 50 museums throughout the nation and even in Europe. Unheard of with the private collection, but it's gained traction, and now it's kind of accepted that Chicano art is a legitimate school of American art, and now soon to be world art, because we've been fortunate enough to be given a museum to house the collection in Riverside, California. So anyways, I'd like to go through some of the paintings, or the paintings in the show that's in this the next room. When you walk out, you can see it. So we're going to show you some of these paintings. I love this one. It's Jacinto Guevara. Oh, isn't this nice? It's what's the name of San Jorge? It's at night and the neon. And, you know, the Chicano painters, a lot of them describe their neighborhoods, you know, and it's just as valid and even more valid than the Impressionists describing their neighborhoods of Montmartre or where, anywhere they grew up in Paris, you know. I mean, these are wonderful insights into their community. Alan Hernandez, he's from El Paso, Texas, and he admitted a school that he's the only adherent to. It's called Chicano Noir, and it always takes place at night, and there's restlessness in his paintings, and there's the wind is always ever present, and there's just his sense of alienation is how he felt growing up. And he lived on the west side of El Paso, in El Medio del Barrio, and he always had this sense of alienation in his color palette. Joe Peña. I just love these paintings of these taco trucks, and it told me the story that when he was going around town shooting these photographically, and he saw this woman. Can I take a picture of you? She goes, why? Typical Chicano attitude. Why? What do you want? And so he says, well, I want to do a painting of it. Can I be in it? Yeah, sure. Just, you know, just go along with your work and make your stuff. And every time he turned around, she'd be. just make your elote and tell them, okay. I love that. But this is, and I love this painting. It just really looks like Fellini, you know. Ricardo Ruiz de Corpus Christi, Texas. Now this one's flat out scary. I don't know. Okay, but I'm drawn to it. You know, because one of the inspirations for me for early art that like how got me into the whole field is I was raised Catholic, and I'd go to mass as a little kid, and like, how long does this stuff go on, man? You know, I'm bored, and it smells good, but, you know. And I'd be wander around, look up at the ceiling, oh, there's paintings up here, and there's guys in sheets, and they're walking around the clouds, and why are they barbecuing that guy? Why does this guy have arrows in him? And so right away I was intrigued, you know, because I like spirituality and mayhem together, you know. So it's simultaneous Luchador and Hieronymus Bosch. You know, it's on two levels simultaneously, two for the price of one. It's a reversible jacket, you know. You can wear it out on the flashy satin side or the velvet side, you know, whatever you want. Look again. The Cheech Marin Center for Chicano Culture and Industry. We call it the Cheech. And I put that name out there right away so everybody could get used to it. I think we should call it the Cheech. Hey, yeah. Caught up in the enthusiasm of the moment. Hey, you know, but we're calling it the Cheech. This is what the museum looks like. But it's a beautiful, 61,420 square feet. The Lord has ordained this. I am just an instrument of his message.
I studied art throughout my life. The gap in my knowledge was contemporary art. I knew kind of names, I heard it, but I didn't really know the scene. So I was married to a painter at the time, and she started taking me to galleries in the West Side in LA. And there was some Chicano painters being shown there, Carlos Almaraz, Frank Romero, Patsy Valdez, Gronk. But what I immediately recognized is these guys can paint, these painters can paint. And because I knew what good painting was, because I'd seen it all my life. And I go, wow, they're good. Why don't they get any shelf space? Well, there was the whole attitude against them, and they weren't considered art. They weren't considered fine art. And they were told by curators of the LA County Museum that Chicanos don't make fine art. They make agitprop folk art at best. You shouldn't tell a Chicano that. The art establishment in New York today does not know what a Chicano is, much less what their art looks like. Today, you go to any gallery on Madison Avenue or Fifth Avenue Chicano, is that like a tasty cheese chip? You know, I like Chicanos, they're cool. I like barbecue flavored Chicanos. It's like, okay. And so I realized in that journey that I, you know, this because you grew up in the society and that I was going to march across the country, we were going to go to New York, we were going to have the big auction at Sotheby's and all the galleries. Never going to happen, because they're invested in their own aesthetic. Because at some point, art is a commodity. You know, it has entered into the art world, and it becomes art bellies. You know, it's like speculating on pork belly futures. You know, and that's what it is, because it's a belief system. Art is a belief system that has no inherent value. These paintings cost to make under $100 or $70, you know, but they can sell for $700 million or $70 million or whatever it is. How is a very ephemeral, transcendental, spiritual art form get turned into hard cash?
Thank you.
No, I've been doing this for a long time. I've been doing this for over 30 years, close to 40 now. And at first it's been a struggle because they didn't want to accept first Chicano art as fine art. We overcame that. And we've played a lot of museums. I've played over now close to 60 museums with the private collections, unheard of, because they don't want to show private collections for a number of reasons. But my argument was always, well, I have this collection because you don't. And it's trying, in the nicest way, to force ourselves into being accepted by the mainstream, by the museum community, because museums are the final imprimatur of cultural acceptance. You know, okay, it's in a museum, so it really is, and here's a standard, and here's the history of it, and this is how it influences society, and makes it real, and okay, it's in a museum, it's real. So I came to the point where what am I going to do with this collection? I mean, keep it under the bed or something? And through a series of coincidences, I was offered a museum to house the collection in Riverside, California, just recently. And it's going to be the home for Chicano art. And it's going to expand from there. It's going to be other collections. There are going to be other kinds of art that will be collected and disseminated throughout the world. And that's my purpose, really, not just to have a collection and you come to the museum and see it. I want to disseminate this journey all over the world so everybody can see that and relate to it as it relates to their own journey. And because it's the same journey. How did we get here? Where are we going? And why are we here? Or, you know, and that's the question that everybody asks throughout their life, if they ask it at all, you know. And art is part of that search.
We're gonna
zip through.
Okay.
Zip through.
All right.
Hello, masses.
Gotta go,
masses. Hello, you people from old countries.
Shush!
Did you?
That's all over.
Trump
just said
that's all over the news cycle today. Trump comes in with a room full of senators. Oh. We don't want.
Hi.
Come on in.
Yes.
It's all over the news.
In Africa and Haiti.
He's got money, I don't think.
This is our president. He's running for piñata next. I'm going to vote. I'll give him 10 votes. All right. You didn't come in and see the show yet, huh? Do you remember my wife, Natasha?
Natasha Sarah.
How are you? I really enjoy being here, and I wouldn't be here if I didn't enjoy being here a great deal. And I also have a bodyguard with a gun, so I'm totally at ease right now. This is our third show that we've put on here at the South Texas Museum, and of all the over 50 museums that this collection has been exhibited in, we get the warmest welcome right here in South Texas. So thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you.
This latest show represents Chicano painters of Texas, and it was when I discovered the Chicano painters of Texas very early in my collecting adventure. I realized that there is a school I'm talking about, that these schools from Los Angeles and San Francisco and now Texas were related. They were like cousins. They were one's more city-minded, one was a little more rural, but they were related. You could see it in their DNA. And I start putting this theory together. This is a school of painting that has not been recognized. It's not getting shelf space. And so I started collecting their work. And 30 years later, we're in our third show at the South Texas Museum. It is truly a school of American art. And at this time in our our political landscape, we need to be brought together as much as we can rather than be divided. And I could say more, but I haven't had enough drinks yet. So thank you very much for coming, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
My father, he was born in the United States. He couldn't speak English. He was punished for speaking Spanish in school. And you get through that because, okay, there's struggles, you get it, but you want to get a job, you want to feed your family, you want to kind of be a part of society, you want to be a policeman, you want to be a captain in the army, you want to be an accountant. All the immigrant dream that every immigrant group has gone through. I always describe the Latino population in this country as a lava flow. You know, you can stand in front of it. I wouldn't recommend it. You know, we come in peace, we do. We come in peace bearing gifts and bearing an eagerness to participate. And that's the American experience. I mean, you know, the American experience is unique. I mean, this is the first time a democracy has ever worked. We're having tests of that experiment right now, people trying to destabilize that belief system. And the only reason it works is because we believe in it. You know, just like art. It's a belief system.